Big Over Easy, an investigation with the Nursery Crime Division, by Jasper Fforde, read by Luke Thompson. Chapter 1. Mary Mary. If Queen Anne hadn't suffered so badly from gout and dropsy, Reading might never have developed at all. In 1702, the unhealthy Queen Anne, looking for a place to ease her royal infirmities, chanced upon Bath, and where royalty goes, so too does society. In consequence, Reading, up until that time a small town on a smaller tributary of the Thames, became a busy staging post on the Bath Road, later to become the A4 and ultimately the M4. The town was enriched by the wool trade and later played host to several large firms that were to become household names. By the time Huntley and Palmer's Biscuits began here in 1822, Simon's Brewery was already well established, and when Sutton's Seeds began in 1835 and Spong's Foot Care in 1853, the town's prosperity was assured. Excerpt from A History of Reading. It was the week following Easter in Reading, and no one could remember the last sunny day. Grey clouds swept across the sky, borne on a chill wind that cut like a knife. It seemed that spring had forsaken the town. The drab winter weather had clung on like a heavy smog, refusing to relinquish its grip. Even the early bloomers were in denial. Only the bravest crocuses had graced the municipal park, and the daffodils, usually a welcome splash of colour after a winter of greyness, had taken one sniff at the cold, damp air and postponed blooming for another year. A police officer was gazing with mixed emotions at the dreary cityscape from the 7th floor of Reading Central Police Station. She was 30 and attractive, dressed up and dated down, worked hard and felt awkward near anyone she didn't know. Her name was Mary. Mary, Mary. And she was from Basingstoke, which is nothing to be ashamed of.
Mary,
said an officer, who was carrying a large potted plant in the manner of someone who thinks it is well outside their job description.
Superintendent Briggs will see you now. How often do you water these things?
That one, replied Mary without emotion. Never. It's plastic.
I'm a policeman, he said unhappily, not a sodding gardener.
And he walked off, mumbling darkly to himself. She turned from the window, approached Briggs's closed door and paused. She gathered her thoughts, took a deep breath and stood up straight. Reading wouldn't have been everyone's choice for a transfer, but for Mary, Reading had one thing that no other city possessed, DCI Friedland Chimes, a veritable powerhouse of a sleuth whose career was a catalogue of inspired police work. His unparalleled detection skills had filled the newspaper columns for over two decades. Chimes was the reason Mary had joined the police force in the first place. Ever since her father had bought her a subscription to Amazing Crime Stories when she was 9, she'd been hooked. She had thrilled at the mystery of the wrong nose, been galvanised by the poisoned shoe, and inspired by the sign of 3.5. 21 years farther on, Friedland was still a serious international player in the world of competitive detecting, and Mary had never missed an issue. Chimes was currently ranked by Amazing Crime 2nd in their annual league rating, just behind Oxford's ever-popular Inspector Moose. Murmured Superintendent Briggs, eyeing Mary's job application carefully as she sat uncomfortably on a plastic chair in an office that was empty apart from a desk, two chairs, them, and a trombone lying on a tattered chaise longue.
Your application is mostly very good, Mary, he said approvingly. I see you were with Detective Inspector Hebden Flo. How did that go?
It hadn't gone very well at all, but she didn't think she'd say so.
We had a fairly good clear-up rate, sir.
I've no doubt you did, but, more importantly, anything published?
It was a question that was asked more and more in promotion boards and transfer interviews, as well as being listed in performance reports. It wasn't enough to be a conscientious and invaluable assistant to one's allotted inspector. You had to be able to write up a readable account for the magazines that the public loved to read. preferably amazing crime stories, but failing that, Sleuth Illustrated. Only one story in print, sir, but I was the youngest officer at Basingstoke to make Detective Sergeant and have two commendations for brave...
The thing is, interrupted Briggs, that the Oxford and Berkshire Constabulary prides itself on producing some of the most readable detectives in the country.
He walked over to the window and looked out at the rain striking the glass.
Modern policing isn't just about catching criminals, Mary. It's about good copy and ensuring that cases can be made into top-notch documentaries on the telly. Public approval is the all-important currency these days, and police budgets ebb and flow on the back of circulation and viewing figures.
Yes, sir.
D.S. Flotsam's work, penning Freeland Chimes' Adventures, is the benchmark to which you should aspire, Mary. Selling the movie rights to Freeland Chimes' The Smell of Fear was a glory moment for everyone at Reading Central, and rightly so. Just one published work, you say? With Flo?
Yes, sir. A two-parter, An Amazing Crime, January to February 1999, and adapted for TV. He nodded his approval.
Well, that's impressive. Primetime dramatisation?
No, sir. Documentary on Mole Cable 62. His face fell. Clearly at Reading, they expected better things. Briggs sat down and looked at her record again.
Now, it says here one reprimand. You struck Detective Inspector Flo with an onyx ashtray. Why was that?
The table lamp was too heavy, she replied, truthfully enough, and if I'd used a chair, it might have killed him.
Which is illegal, of course, added Briggs, glad for an opportunity to show off his legal knowledge. What happened? Personal entanglements?
Equal blame on both sides, sir, she replied, thinking it would be better to be impartial over the whole affair. I was foolish. He was emotionally dishonest. Briggs closed the file.
Well, I don't blame you. Hebden was always a bit of a bounder. He pinged my partner's bra strap at an office party once, you know. She wasn't wearing it at the time, he added after a moment's reflection, but the intention was clear.
That sounds like D.I. Flo, replied Mary. Briggs drummed his fingers on the desk for a moment.
Do you want to hear me play the trombone?
Might it be prejudicial to my career if I were to refuse?
It's a distinct possibility.
Then I'd be delighted. So Briggs walked over to the chaise longue, picked up the trombone, worked the slide a couple of times, and blew a few notes, much to the annoyance of whoever had the office next door, who started to thump angrily on the wall.
Drug squad,
explained Briggs unhappily, putting the instrument down.
Complete heathens. Never appreciate a good tune.
I was wondering, said Mary, before he had a chance to start playing again, this detective sergeant's job I'm applying for... Who is it with?
Briggs looked at his watch.
An excellent question. In 10 minutes, we're holding a press conference. I have a detective in urgent need of a new sergeant, and I think you'll fit the bill perfectly. Shall we?
The press room was 5 floors below, and an expectant journalistic hubbub greeted their ears while they were still walking down the corridor. They stepped inside and stood as unobtrusively as possible at the back of the large and airy room. Mary could see from the Oxford and Berkshire Constabulary-bedecked podium and high turnout that press conferences here were taken with a great deal more seriousness than she had known hitherto, which probably reflected this city's preeminence over Basingstoke when it came to serious crime. It wasn't that Reading had any more murders than Basingstoke, it just had better ones. Reading and the Thames Valley area were more of a fairy cakes laced with strychnine or strangulation with a silk handkerchief sort of place, where there are always bags of interesting suspects, convoluted motives and seemingly insignificant clues hidden in an inquiry of incalculable complexity which was nevertheless solved within a week or two. By contrast, murders in Basingstoke were strictly blunt instruments, drunkenly wielded, solved within the hour, or not at all. Mary had worked on 6 murder investigations and to her great disappointment hadn't once discovered one of those wonderful clues that seemed to have little significance but later, in an epiphanic moment, turn the case on its head and throw the guilty light on someone previously eliminated from inquiries. She didn't have time to muse upon the imaginative shortcomings of Basingstoke's criminal fraternity any longer, as there was a sudden hushing of the pressman, a burst of spontaneous applause, and a handsome man in his mid-50s strode dramatically from a side door.
"Goodness," said Mary. "That's..."
"Yep," said Briggs, with the pride of a father who had just seen his son win everything at sports day.
"Detective Inspector Friedland Chimes."
Friedland Chimes. In person. There was a hush as the famous detective stepped up to the podium. The assembled 24 newspapermen readied themselves, pens poised, for his statement.
"Thank you for attending," he began, sweeping back his blonde hair and gazing around the room with his lively blue eyes, causing flutters when they lingered ever so slightly on the women present in the room, Mary included. She found herself almost automatically attracted to him. He was strong, handsome, intelligent, fearless, the most alpha of alpha males. Working with him would be an honour.
"It was the small traces of pastry around the gunshot wound on Colonel Peabody's corpse that turned the case for me," began the great detective, his sonorous tones filling the air like music. "Minute quantities of shortcrust, whose butter-flour ratio I found to be identical to a medium-sized Bowyer's pork pie. The assailant had fired his weapon through the tasty snack to muffle the sound of the shot. The report heard later was a firecracker set off by a time fuse, thus giving an alibi to the assailant, whom I can reveal to you now was..."
The whole room leaned forward in expectation. Chimes, his only apparent vanity a certain showmanship, paused for dramatic effect before announcing the killer.
"Miss Celia Mangerson, the victim's niece, and unbeknown to us all, the sole beneficiary of the missing will, which I found hidden, as expected, within a hollowed-out statuette of Sir Walter Scott. Yes, Mr. Hatchett, you have a question?"
Josh Hatchett of the Toad newspaper had raised his hand in the front row.
"What was the significance of the traces of custard found on the Colonel's sock suspender?"
Friedland raised a finger in the air.
"An excellent question, Mr. Hatchett, and one which pushed my powers of deduction to the limit. Bear with me, if you will, while we go through the final moments of Colonel Peabody's life. Mortally wounded and with only seconds to live, he had somehow to leave a clue to his assailant's identity. A note? Of course not. The killer would find and destroy it. Guessing correctly that a murder of this magnitude would be placed in my hands, he decided to leave behind a clue that only I could solve. Knowing the Colonel's penchant for anagrams, it was but a swift move to deduce his reasoning. The sock suspender was made in France. Custard, in French, is crème anglaise, and an anagram of this is Celia Mangerson, which not only correctly identified the killer, but also told me the Colonel died before he was able to finish the anagram."
There was more applause, and he quietened everyone down before continuing.
"But since anagram-related clues are now inadmissible as evidence, we sent the pork pie off for DNA analysis and managed to pinpoint the pie shop where it was purchased. Guessing that Miss Mangerson might have an affinity for the pies, we staked out the shop in question, and yesterday evening Miss Mangerson was taken into custody, whereupon she confessed to me in a tearful scene that served as a dramatic closure to the case. My loyal and annoyingly chirpy Cockney assistant and biographer, D.S. Flotsam, will, of course, be writing a full report for Amazing Crime Stories in due course, after the formality of a trial. Ladies and gentlemen, the case is closed."
The assembled journalists rose as one and burst into spontaneous applause. Chimes dismissed the adulation with a modest wave of the hand and excused himself, muttering something about needing to open a hospital for orphan sick children.
"He's amazing," breathed Mary,
somehow convincing herself, as had all the other women present, that Chimes had winked at her across the crowded room.
"I agree," replied Briggs, standing aside as the newsmen filed out, eager to get the stories into the late editions. "Don't you love that the case is closed stuff? I wish I had a catchphrase. He's an asset, not only to us here at Reading, but also to the nation. There aren't many countries that haven't requested his thoughts on some intractable and ludicrously complex inquiry."
"He's remarkable," agreed Mary.
"Indeed," went on Briggs,
seemingly swept up in a paroxysm of hagiographic hero worship.
He's also a hilarious raconteur, has a golf handicap of 2, was twice world aerobatic champion, and plays the clarinet as well as Artie Shaw. Speaks 8 languages, too, and is often consulted by the Jellyman himself on important matters of state.
I'm going to enjoy working with him, I can see, replied Mary happily. When do I start?
Chimes, echoed Briggs, with a faint yet unmistakably patronising laugh. Good gracious, no. You're not working with Chimes.
Who then? Asked Mary, attempting to hide her disappointment and failing.
Him.
Mary followed Briggs's outstretched finger to an untidy figure who had taken his turn at the podium. He was in his mid-40s, had greying hair, and one eye marginally higher than the other, giving him the lopsided look of someone deep in thought. If he was deep in thought, considered Mary, it was clearly something more important than his personal appearance. His suit could have done with a good pressing. His hair needed to be any way but the way he had it. He might have shaved a little less hurriedly and made more of an attempt to exude some, any confidence. He fumbled with his papers as he stared resignedly after the rapidly vanishing press corps.
I see, said Mary, a great deal more coldly than she had intended. And who's he?
Briggs patted her arm in a fatherly manner. He could sense her disappointment, but it wasn't up to him. Chimes picked his own people.
That's D.I. Jack Spratt of the Nursery Crime Division, the NCD. You'll be on his team, or at least you and a few others will be the team. It's one of our smallest departments.
He thought for a moment and then added,
Actually, it is our smallest department, if you don't count the night shift in the canteen.
And his Amazing Crime Stories rating? What about that?
He's not rated, replied Briggs, trying to make it sound all matter-of-fact and not the embarrassment that it was. In fact, I don't think he's even in the guild.
Mary stared at the shabby figure and felt her heart fall. All of a sudden, D.I. Flo didn't seem quite so bad after all. Jack Spratt looked around the room. Most of the newsmen had left by now, and aside from Briggs and a woman Spratt didn't recognise by the door, there were only 2 people still in the room. The first was a large man named Archibald Fatquack, who was the editor of the Reading Weekly Gossip Sheet, The Gadfly. The second was a junior newshound from the Reading Daily Eye Strain, who appeared to be asleep, drunk, dead, or a mixture of all 3. Thank you all for attending this press conference, announced Jack in a sombre tone to the good-as-empty room. I'll try not to keep you any longer than is necessary. This afternoon, the Reading Central Criminal Court found the 3 pigs not guilty of all charges relating to the first-degree murder of Mr. Wolfe. He sighed. If he was intending it to be a dramatic statement, it wasn't, and it didn't help that no one significant was there to witness it. He could still hear the excited yet increasingly distant chatter of the newsmen as they filed down the corridor, but it was soon drowned out by Friedland's 1932 Delage D8 Supersport, which started up with a throaty roar in the car park. Jack waited until he had gone, then continued gamely, the extreme lack of interest not outwardly affecting his demeanour. After nearly 20 years, he was kind of used to it. Since the death by scalding of Mr. Wolfe, following his ill-fated climb down Little Pig C's chimney, we at the Nursery Crime Division have been following evidence that this was not an act of self-defence, but a violent and premeditated murder by 3 individuals who, far from being the innocent victims of wolf porcine crime, actually sought confrontation and then acted quite beyond what might be described as reasonable self-defence. Jack paused for breath. If he had hoped his misgivings over the outcome of the trial would be splashed all over the paper, he was mistaken. Page 16 of The Gadfly was about the sum total for this particular story, sandwiched ignominiously between a 3-for-2 hemorrhage relief advert and the very Reverend Conrad Pooh's weekly dental hygiene column.
Mr. Spratt,
began Archibald, slowly bringing himself up to speed like a chilled gecko,
is it true that Mr. Wolfe once belonged to the Lupine Brotherhood, a secret society dedicated to traditional wolfish pursuits, such as the outlawed midnight howling?
Yes, I understand that to be the case, replied Jack,
but that was over 15 years ago. We do not deny that he has been investigated over various charges of criminal damage arising from the destruction of two dwellings built by the younger pigs, nor that Mr. Wolf threatened to eat them all up. But we saw this as an empty threat. We found witnesses who swore that Mr. Wolf was a vegetarian of many years' standing.
So, what was your basis for a murder prosecution?
Asked Archie, scratching his head. We believed, replied Jack in exasperation, as he had made the same point in the same room to the same two uninterested journalists many times before, that boiling Mr. Wolf alive was quite outside the realm of reasonable force, and the fact that the large pan of water would have taken at least 6 hours to reach boiling point strongly indicated premeditation. Archibald said nothing, and Jack, eager to go home, wrapped up his report. Despite the not guilty verdicts, we at the NCD feel we have put up a robust case and were fully justified in our actions. To this end, we will not be looking to re-examine the case or interview anyone else in connection with Mr. Wolfe's death. Jack sighed and looked down. He appeared and felt drained.
Personally, said Briggs in an aside, I didn't think the jury would go for it. The problem is that small pigs elicit a strong sympathetic reaction and large wolves don't. There was a good case for self-defence too. Mr. Wolf was trespassing when he climbed down the chimney. It really all hinged on whether you believed that the pigs were boiling up a huge tureen of water to do their washing. And the jury did, in only 8 minutes. Do you want me to introduce you?
I'd prefer tomorrow once I'm officially on duty, said Mary quickly, thinking she might have to go outside and scream or something.
Briggs picked up on her reticence.
Don't underestimate the Nursery Crime Division, Mary. Spratt does some good work, not high profile, you understand, but important. His work on the Bluebeard serial wife killings case was mostly good, solid police work.
That was Spratt?
Asked Mary, something vaguely stirring in her memory. It hadn't been an amazing crime, of course. It was just one of those also-ran stories you usually find dwelling in the skim-read part of the dailies, along with city prices, dog horoscopes and true-life photo stories. It had been under the subheading, Colourfully Hirsute Gentleman Kills Nine Wives, Hidden Room Contained Gruesome Secret.
That's him. Jack was on to Bluebeard and was well ahead of events.
If nine wives died, he couldn't have been that good.
I said it was mostly good police work. More notably, he arrested Rumpelstiltskin over that spinning straw into gold scam and was part of the team that captured the violently dangerous psychopath, the Gingerbread Man. You might have heard about Jack in connection with some giant killing, too.
Something stirred in Mary's memory again, and she raised an eyebrow. Police officers weren't meant to kill people if they could help it. And giants were no exception.
Don't worry, said Briggs. It was self-defence. Mostly.
Mostly?
The last one he ran over in a car.
The last one? Repeated Mary incredulously. How many have there been?
Four, but don't mention it. He's a bit sensitive over the issue.
Mary's heart, which had already fallen fairly far, fell farther. Well, that's all I have to say, said Jack to the sparsely populated room. Are there any more questions? Archibald Fatquack stirred, scribbled in his pad, but said nothing. The reporter from the Reading Daily Eye Strain had moved slowly forward during Jack's report until his head was resting on the seat back in front. He began to snore.
Good. Well, thank you very much for your time. Don't all rush to get out. You might wake Jim over there.
"'I wasn't asleep,' said Jim, eyes tightly closed. "'I heard every word.'
"'Even the bit about the bears escaping into the Oracle Centre "'and eating a balloon cellar?'
"'Of course,'
he murmured, beginning to snore again. Jack picked up his notes and disappeared through a side door.
"'Are there usually this few people for his press conferences?'
asked Mary, horrified at the prospect of the career black hole "'into which she was about to descend like a suicidal rabbit.'
Good Lord, no, replied Briggs in a shocked tone. Often he has no press at all.
He looked at his watch.
Goodness, is that the time? Check in with me first thing tomorrow and I'll introduce you to Jack. You'll like him. Not exactly charismatic, but diligent and generally correct in most... some of his assumptions.
Sir, I was wondering... Briggs stopped her mid-sentence, divining precisely what she was about to say. The reason was simple. All the detective sergeants he had ever allocated to Jack said the same thing.
Look upon it as a baptism of fire. The NCD is good training.
For what? Briggs had to think for a moment.
Unconventional policing. Your time won't be wasted. Oh, and one other thing.
Yes, sir?
Welcome to Reading.
Chapter 2. Jack Spratt. In Inside the Guild of Detectives, we learn the most worshipful guild of detectives was founded by Holmes in 1896 to look after the best interests of Britain's most influential and newsworthy detectives. Membership is strictly controlled but pays big dividends. The pick of the best inquiries in England and Wales, an opportunity to brainstorm tricky cases with one's peers, and an exclusive deal with the notoriously picky editors of amazing crime stories. The Guild's legal department frequently brokers TV, movie, and merchandising deals, and membership usually sways juries in tricky cases. It seems to work well. The only people who didn't like the system are the officers who are non-guild. Jack drove home that evening with a feeling of frustration that would have been considerably worse had it been unexpected. He and the prosecution had tried to present the pig case as well as they could, but for some reason, the jury didn't buy it. Briggs hadn't said anything to him yet, but mounting prosecutions such as the Crown versus Three Pigs was undeniably expensive, and after the failed conviction of the con men who perpetrated the celebrated Emperor's New Clothes scam the year before, Jack knew that the Nursery Crime Division would be under closer scrutiny by the bean counters. Not that the NCD was consistently racked with failure, far from it, but the fact was that few of his cases attracted much publicity. And in the all-important climate of increased public confidence, budget accountability and amazing crime circulation figures, Friedland's crowd-pleasing antics were strides ahead of Jack's misadventures, and hugely profitable for the Reading police force too. But all of this was scant comfort to Mr. Wolfe, who went to his casket unavenged and parboiled. He drove along Peppard and took the left fork into Kidmore End. Shit, muttered Jack under his breath, as the whole wasted six-month investigation sank in. He didn't want murder cases, of course. He would be happier not to have any, ever. But there was a slight frisson that went with them that he welcomed. The NCD, after an early rush of celebrated cases, had settled down into something of a workaday existence. There is a limit to how many lost sheep you can track down, how many illegal straw into gold dens he could uncover, how many pied pipers arrived in town trying to extort money from the authorities over pest control, and how often Mr. Punch would beat his wife and throw the baby downstairs. He knew there was not much prestige, but there was an upside. He was left pretty much to his own devices. He stopped the car outside his house and stared silently into his own kitchen, where he could see his wife, Madeline, attempting to feed the youngest of their five children. They had brought two children each from previous marriages. The two eldest, Pandora and Ben, were Jack's, and Megan and Jerome were Madeline's. As if to cement the union further, they had had one that was entirely down to the pair of them, Stevie, who was a year old.
This is why I do this,
he muttered under his breath, opening the car door. Pausing only to place a block of wood under one of the rear wheels to stop his Allegro from rolling down the slope, he picked up his case, bade good evening to his neighbour, Mrs. Sitcom, who was glaring suspiciously at him from over the fence, and took the side entrance to the house. "Honey," he yelled without enthusiasm as he dumped his case on the hall table. "I'm home." She cooeyed from the kitchen, and the sound of her voice made all the stresses of the day that much more bearable. They had been married almost 5 years, and neither of them had any regrets over their choice. She bounded in from the kitchen, gave him a kiss and hugged him tenderly.
Otto called me about the wolf thing, she whispered in his ear. Bum deal. The pigs deserve to fry. I'm sorry.
And she hugged him again. I'd say some you win, but I don't seem... She placed a finger on his lips and took him by the hand to walk him through to the kitchen, where Stevie was attempting to reduce his dinner to a thin film that might, through careful application of skill, be made to cover the entire room. "Hi, kids," he shouted, summoning a small amount of enthusiasm.
"Hello,"
said Jerome, who was just 8, was enthusiastic about everything and smelt strongly of fish fingers.
"I can wiggle my ears."
He then attempted to demonstrate his newfound skill, and after about a minute of grunting and going bright red, and with his ears not wiggling even the tiniest bit, said,
"How was that?"
"Awesome," replied Jack, rolling his eyes dramatically. "Wiggle them any more and you'll be able to fly."
"Jack," began Megan, her mouth full, "my teacher, Miss Clark, eats puppies."
"And how do you know that?"
"Johnny said so,"
she replied intensely, all curls and big questioning blue eyes, the colour of a Caribbean lagoon.
"I see. And does Johnny have any corroborative evidence?"
"Of course,"
said the 10-year-old, knowing a few technical police terms herself.
"Johnny said that Roger told him that a friend of his who lives next door to someone who knows Miss Clark said it's a fact in her street. Do we have a case?"
"Oh, yes," agreed Jack. "I often go to court with far less."
"Dawoo!"
screamed Stevie, waving a spoon as he scattered food around the room, much to the pleasure of the cat, with whom, it was generally agreed, Stevie had an understanding. Rip Van, as in Winkle, naturally, was the laziest cat that had ever lived, ever. She would sleep in corridors, roads, paths, puddles, gutters, anywhere where it suddenly felt tired. She would rather sit in the cold and have to be revived from near hypothermia with a hairdryer than trouble herself to use the cat flap. If she hadn't had the sense to lie on her back under Stevie's high chair with her mouth open, she would probably have starved. Madeline sidled up to where Jack was absently staring at the children gorging themselves and wrapped an arm around his waist.
"How are you feeling?"
she asked. "Deflated," he replied, and Friedland got another standing ovation at the press conference.
"Don't worry about Friedland,"
said Madeline soothingly. "He only gets the good cases because he's in the Guild of Detectives." "Don't talk to me about the Guild. Heard the saying, if you're in, you're made, if you're out, you're traffic."
"Many times, but you're not traffic."
"Check in again a week from now."
"Did you apply as we discussed, darling?"
"Yes."
"Really?"
"No, listen, I'm not really guild material. How many people want to read about 3 disreputable pigs and a dopey wolf with a disposition towards house demolition?"
"If you were in the guild, maybe lots."
"Well, I'm not so sure.
The guild won't want someone like me. The NCD conviction record is... well, shite." "That's because the force doesn't appreciate what you're doing. If you were Guild, Briggs and the Crown Prosecution Service would soon change their tune. Aside from that, Ben and Pandora will both be at university in 2 years, so we could do with the extra cash."
"That's true. The cost of pot noodle, subsidised beer and cannabis these days is simply scandalous. Think I can get a cheap deal from the drug squad?"
"I'm serious, Jack."
Okay, I'll apply tomorrow, I promise."
"You won't need to. I took the liberty of doing it for you. Here."
She handed him a sheet of paper. Jack accepted it with misgivings, unsure of whether to be angry at Madeline's intervention or glad that she had taken the burden of responsibility from him. "It's a conditional acceptance," he said, reading the short letter twice to make sure he understood what was going on. "They need a day's observation in order to calculate my sleuthing quotient. If it's higher than a 6.3, they'll put my name up to the board." He turned the sheet over. "It doesn't say when this observation day will be."
"I think it's done on a random basis in case detectives try to spice things up a bit with a head in a bag or something,"
observed Madeline. She was quite correct. Desperate wannabe guild detectives had been known to borrow cadavers from medical schools and then dump them in a chest freezer for later discovery to impress guild observers. "Well," said Jack, "I'm just amazed that I got even as far as a conditional acceptance."
"That's easily explained," she replied. "I told them you were a chain-smoking, vintage Rolls-Royce driving, divorced alcoholic with an ability to form lasting relationships and with a love of Puccini, Henry Moore and Magritte and a big pipe."
"What about a deerstalker hat?"
"No. Do you think I should have?"
Absolutely not. Why did you tell them all that?
I had to write something interesting about you. If your investigations are going to be written up in amazing crime stories, you're going to have a few interesting foibles. I don't think happily married father of five quite cuts the mustard these days.
He sighed. She was right.
Well, he said, giving her an affectionate hug, if I'm going to be a womanising, pipe-smoking opera fanatic with a vintage car and a drink problem, I'd better practice getting into character. I could make a start chatting up that new assistant of yours. What was her name again?
Diane. Sure, you could try that. She said yesterday she thought you were really nice.
She did?
Reminded her of her dad, she said.
What sort of pipe did you have in mind for me? They laughed. The Guild. What the hell? He'd crossed that bridge when he came to it.
Bums! Said Madeline, glancing at the wall clock. I'm late.
Late for what?
The Spong Foot Care charity benefit is on the calendar.
Jack walked over to look. It was there in black biro. He didn't look closely enough at these things and was always being caught out.
Schmoozing or snapping? She slapped him playfully on the shoulder.
Snapping, you dope. Someone has to take pictures of all the dazzling Reading socialites shaking hands with whatever D-class celebrity Lord Spong has managed to dredge up.
Is that an improvement on the Thames Valley Fruit Growers Ball, where you were merely photographing low-grade celebrity wannabes?
Of course, dear. It's called upward mobility. By the summer, I could be doing portraits of chinless twerps at the Henley Regatta.
Well, you'd better dress up a bit, then.
All in good time, husband dearest. Can you take Megan to Scouts?
Sure. When is it again?
7,
said Megan, and excused herself from the table.
What did you do at school, Jerome?
Asked Jack when Madeline had gone upstairs to change into something a little smarter. It didn't do well to turn up at a charity bash dressed scruffily, even if you were only the photographer.
Nothing much.
And it's a bit pointless sending you, isn't it? Why don't we just cancel school and you can stay at home and, I don't know, just eat chocolate and watch TV all day?
Jerome perked up at this gold-edged scenario.
Really?
No, not really. His shoulders slumped.
But school's so boring.
Agreed, but it's almost perfect training for a career at Smiley Burgers.
But I'm not going to work at Smiley Burgers.
You will if you do nothing much at school.
Dowel!
Yelled Stevie, jumping up and down. In the absence of anything more productive to do, he grasped large handfuls of scrambled egg and squeezed until it oozed between his fingers like yellow toothpaste.
Yuck, said Jerome. And you tell me off for picking my nose?
It's not the picking, explained Jack, who secretly liked a good dig himself and didn't want to be a hypocrite. It's the eating. Talk abruptly halted as Ben walked into the kitchen, looking very self-conscious in his college orchestra uniform. He was 16, gangly, and awash in a toxic sea of hormones. He had joined the orchestra less through love of music than love of Penelope Liddle, who played the harp.
It's those slender fingers plucking on the strings,
he had explained while confessing the object of his adoration to Jack a few days before.
And that concentration! Hell's teeth, if she looked at me like that, I think I'd explode.
Well, mind you don't, Jack had replied. Could be very messy.
Ben was actually a very competent tuba player, but since the tuba section is about as far away as you can get from the harp and the tuba doesn't exactly ooze macho sexuality, except perhaps to another tuba, he had joined the percussion section to bring him closer to the object of his affections. He dragged 2 heavy cases out from the cupboard under the stairs and put on a parka.
Do you need a hand with those? Asked Jack.
Thanks, Dad. My ride will be here soon.
A car horn sounded outside. Jack tried to pick up one of the cases, but it was so heavy it felt as though it had taken root.
What the hell have you got in here?
We're doing Il Trovatore, Ben explained. Mr. Moore said we should experiment, so I'm using real anvils and real hammers.
Between the two of them, they managed to drag the cases across the floor, heave them over the doorstep and down the path to the boot of the waiting car, which sank alarmingly. Half an hour later, Madeline came back down, dressed in a strapless red ball gown kept up by nothing but faith. All eyes were on her as she did a twirl for them in the kitchen.
How do I look?
Whoa, said Pandora, who had just walked in. Maddie's in girl clothes.
Beautiful,
said Megan wistfully, clasping her hands together and holding them up to her chin, dreaming of a time when she could dress up in ball gowns, go to parties, and be kissed by a handsome prince. Although she would accept a night if there were problems regarding availability.
"It's very bright," was Jerome's only comment. "Dowoo," said Stevie.
"I thought you were the one doing the photographing," said Jack. "I mean, how do you actually get in your own photographs? Press the shutter and then run round really fast?"
"It is the Spong Foot Care charity benefit, darling. While I've still the tattered remnants of youth and good looks, I might as well use them to drum up some work. Deb's parents pay good money for portraits."
"Well," said Jack, "just don't allow yourself to be chatted up by Lord Spong. You know what a reputation he has."
"I have every intention of being chatted up by Lord Spong," she responded with a smile. "I need all the work he can give me."
She curled a hand around Jack's chin and neck, brought her lips to his ear and whispered,
"These dresses are notoriously tight and the zips are always faulty. You may have to tear it from my body."
She kissed him, smiled and withdrew. "I'll wait up."
"Oh, no need for that, is there?"
she returned playfully.
"Yes."
She laughed and was suddenly a burst of energy.
"Megan, get your shoes on now. If you can't find a woggle, use an elastic band. The rest of you behave yourselves with Jack. I'll be back after your bedtime."
She kissed them all, grabbed her camera bag, which spoiled the illusion of sophisticated socialising, and was out of the door in a flash.
"Da-woo,"
murmured Stevie, clearly impressed. It was after 10. The younger children were all tucked up, and Jack and Pandora were sitting in the living room. The telly was on, although they weren't paying it much attention, and Pandora was doing some revising. Several textbooks on theoretical particle physics were strewn around the sofa. Pandora was almost 20, and still at the sort of age where she didn't really care what her father thought of her life choices and wanted him to know it, which naturally meant she cared a great deal what he thought, but wasn't going to let on. And Jack, for his part, couldn't help giving her advice that he thought valuable and pertinent, but was actually useless, mostly because it had been a long time since he was her age, and he hadn't been able to figure it out either. But there were small triumphs. For a start, Pandora didn't have any piercings or tattoos. This was partly due to Jack's relaxed attitude, something that took the wind out of her semi-rigged rebellious sails. Sometimes she thought Jack was using reverse psychology on her, which meant that she should double bluff his double bluff, and she might have done so, except that the idea of a tattoo or a piercing made her feel queasy. Jack stared blankly at his crossword. It was the 344th consecutive puzzle he had failed to complete. A new personal best.
"Hey," said Pandora. "Tough break on the three pigs case. I'm a committed holier-than-thou meat's murder bore the pants off all and sundry vegetarian, and even I thought they should have been served up boiled with new potatoes, peas and parsley sauce."
"Well," replied Jack, taking a swig of beer, "we thought we might have got Gerald, that's little pig A, to squeal on his elder brothers for a lesser sentence, but he wouldn't play ball."
"How's school?"
"I'm nearly 20, Dad. I don't go to school anymore. It's called university, and it's good. Can you help me with my quantum particle homework?"
"Sure."
"Okay, here's the question. Solve the Schrödinger equation explicitly in the case of a particle of mass m in a constant Newtonian gravitational field, V equals mgz."
Jack thought for a moment.
"Definitely B."
"Hey?"
"Box B, unless the previous answer was box B, in which case it'll be box C. This is multiple choice, yes?"
Pandora laughed.
"No, Dad. Particle physics is a little more involved than that."
"Box A?"
She slapped him playfully on the arm.
"Dad, you are so no help at all."
The local news came on. There was a piece about Chimes and the Peabody case, of course, and more about the Jelly Man's visit on Saturday to dedicate the sacred Gonga's Visitor's Centre. There was also a bit about the Spong Foot Care charity benefit, live from the Deja Vu ballrooms. They both craned their necks to catch a glimpse of Madeline in her red dress and saw her lurking in the back of a shot where Lord Randolph Spong, the CEO of Spong Foot Care PLC, was doing a piece for the live broadcast.
As well as representatives from Winsome and Loosome's and Quantec, we've seen a galaxy of Reading celebrities tonight, said the handsome peer cheerfully, in order to help us raise funds to replace the outdated and woefully inadequate St. Cerebellum's Mental Hospital. We are very grateful indeed to Mr. Grundy, Mr. Attery Squash, the Blue Baboon, Mr. Pobble, Lola Vavoom, and of course the Dong, who so generously agreed to entertain us with his luminous nose. Ah yes, Miss Vavoom, said the Toad reporter as he crossed to the retired star of screen and stage. So good to see you out in Reading society again. How do you react to the epithet formerly gorgeous? Like this, she said, downing the reporter with a straight right to the jaw. There was a cry, a flash going off, and they cut the live broadcast back to a bemused anchorman who hid a smile, told a heartwarming story about the efforts of the fire service to rescue a kitten stuck in a pipe, then introduced Reading's favourite weather girl, Bunty McTwinkle.
Reading will once again experience a cloudy day with little sign of sunshine, said Bunty without much emotion. A bit like living inside Tupperware.
Pandora keyed the remote, and the TV went silent. I was hoping I might make the local news this time, said Jack despondently, even if it was to be trashed. Ben finally drifted in at 11 and made a little too much noise. A light came on in Mr. and Mrs. Sitcom's bedroom, which was always a bad sign. Jack beckoned him in as quickly as he could.
Have you been drinking? To excess. I had two shandies.
Almost an alcoholic. How did it go with the harpist? Did she like your anvils?
Oh, her? He sniffed, taking off his parka and chucking it in the cloakroom. She's going out with Brian Eves, who plays the tuba. She says it's the sexiest instrument in the brass section.
Oh, Ben, said Jack.
I'm so sorry. Shit happens, he replied, making his way towards the staircase, his room, and the welcome oblivion of low alcohol-induced lovelorn unconsciousness. Yeah, indeed, shit happens.
Jack went to bed at midnight and was awoken in the small hours by Madeline, who came to bed smelling of champagne, canapes, and hard work.
Guess what?
She whispered, not at all quietly in his ear. The house is on fire?
No, I snapped Lola Vavoom slugging a journalist. He'll be on the front page of The Mole and The Toad tomorrow. She packs quite a punch. They had to wire his jaw.
Despite the feisty and provocative talk earlier about the red dress having to be torn from her body, they both fell fast asleep doing nothing about it. Besides, it was rented. Chapter 3. The Fall Guy. The Gadfly's edition of the 10th of August 1984's headline read, Promotion First for Nursery Crime Division. History was made yesterday when D.I. Friedland Chimes was promoted out of the Nursery Crime Division, the first occasion of this happening in the department's 26-year history. Traditionally a depository for loners, losers, burnouts, misfits, oddballs, and those out of favour with higher authority, Chimes' elevation has finally shown that the NCD can hold its own in the production of guild-quality officers to protect, serve, and entertain the nation.
The Japanese film crew is waiting to interview you again, said Madeline, interspersing stuffing spoonfuls of mashed banana into Stevie with surreptitious glances outside. What do they want, anyway?
To talk to me about Friedland Chimes and the gingerbread man, replied Jack, sorting through his post and finding a notice from the Allegro Owners Club about checking wheel-bearing torque settings.
Why don't you speak to them?
Darling, they don't want the truth. They want me to back up Chimes' version of events, whereby he saved the day and single-handedly caught the deranged psychopath. Jack finished his toast and looked at Madeline's picture on the cover of The Toad, which sported the headline, Washed up has-been with weight problem viciously attacks journalist. The Mole, whose journalist didn't get a broken jaw that night, led with Sock it to him, Lola.
Whatever happened to him?
Asked Madeline. Friedland Chimes, no idea.
No, silly. The gingerbread man.
Last I heard, he was still in St. Cerebellum's secure wing for the incurably unhinged. 400-year sentence. It should have been 500, but we never proved his 104th victim.
He couldn't escape, could he? Asks Madeline. After all, he did promise to do unspeakable things to you and Friedland.
If he did, I'd be the first to know. He sighed. No, I guess I'd be the second.
Jack's mobile vibrated across the worktop and fell into the compost bin with a plop. He picked it up, wiped off the spaghetti hoops, and frowned at the text message.
Gingerbread man out to get you,
he murmured.
Now that's a coincidence.
Madeline dropped a spoon and Jack chuckled. Just kidding. He actually says, big egg down, Wyatt. What does that mean?
I don't know, replied Madeline. But if the husband with the dopey line and practical jokes wants to still be breathing in 10 minutes, he'd better be out of the house.
Wyatt was Briggs's deputy, and not the most polite of men.
Are you coming in today?
He asked as soon as Jack called. Jack glanced at his watch. It was barely 9. Of course, what's the problem?
Wolf all over at Grimm's Road. Looks like one of yours. Briggs is on his way and wants to see you there pronto.
Jack replied that he'd be over as soon as possible, scribbled down the address and hung up.
What was it?
One for the NCD, apparently.
Another Bluebeard copycat?
I hope not. Are you interviewing any more potential lodgers today?
2.
Good. No one weird, remember? I'll call you. He kissed her, then looked over Stevie to find the least sticky area. He eventually found a small patch on the top of his head and kissed that, kissed Madeline again, and was out of the door. Jack's car was an Austin Allegro Mark III Estate, painted in a gruesome shade of lime green that had been designated as Applejack by an unnamed marketing executive with an odd sense of humour. Detectives driving vintage or classic cars was a guild-inspired affectation that Jack thought ludicrous. Friedland Chimes's 1932 Delage D8 was a not untypical choice. As a small, pointless and totally unnoticed act of rebellion, Jack drove the dullest car he could find. His father had bought it new in 1982 and looked after it assiduously. When it passed to Jack, he continued to care for it. It was just coming up to its 22nd birthday and had covered almost 350,000 miles, wearing out 2 engines and 4 clutches on the way. He didn't drive straight to Grimm's Road. He had an errand to run first, for his mother. She opened the door within 2 seconds of him pressing the doorbell, letting out a stream of cats that ran around with such rapidity and randomness of motion that they assumed a liquid state of furry purringness. The exact number could have been as low as 3 or as high as 108. No one could ever tell, as they were all so dangerously hyperactive. The years had been charitable to Mrs. Spratt, and despite her age, she was as bright as a button, and had certainly not lost any of her youthful zest. Jack put it down to the number of children. It had either made her tough in old age or worn her out. If the latter, then without Jack and his 9 elder siblings, she might have lived to 196. She painted people's pets in oils because someone has to, collected small pottery animals, blue baboon LPs and jellyman commemorative plates. She had been widowed 17 years.
Hello, baby, she enthused merrily. How are you?
I'm fine, Mother, and I'm not the baby anymore. I'm 44.
You'll always be my baby. Did the pigs dangle?
Jack shook his head.
We did our best. The jury just wasn't convinced we had a case.
It's hardly surprising, she snorted, considering the jury was completely biased.
The defendants might be pigs, Mother, but they do have the right to be tried by their peers. In this instance, 12 other pigs. It's a Magna Carta 1215 thing. Nothing to do with me or the prosecution service.
She shrugged and then looked furtively around.
Best come inside. I think the aliens are trying to control my thoughts using the mobile network.
Jack sighed.
Mother, if you met an alien, you'd quickly change your mind. They really just like you and me, only blue.
She ushered him in and shut the door. The house smelt of lavender water, acrylic paint and fresh baking, and it echoed with the stately tock of the grandfather clock in the hall. A quantum of cats shot out of the living room and tore upstairs.
It's the diet I have them on, I think, she murmured, passing Jack a canvas wrapped in brown paper.
She didn't really want to sell her Stubbs painting of a cow, but since she had discovered all the must-have goodies on eBay, there was really no choice.
Remember, she said firmly. Take it to Mr. Foozle and get him to value it. I'll make a decision after he's done that.
Right. She thought for a moment.
By the way, when are you going to remove those 3 bags of wool from the potting shed so I can have it demolished?
Soon, Mother, I promise. The rain had eased up after the previous night's deluge, and puddles the size of small inland seas gathered on the roads where the beleaguered storm drains had failed to carry it all away. Grimm's Road was in an area that had yet to fully benefit from the town's prosperity. There were terraced houses either side of the potholed road, and 2 large gas holders dominated the far end of the street, casting a shadow over the houses every month of the year except July. The houses had been built at the end of the 19th century and were typical of the period. 2 up, 2 down, with kitchen behind, an outdoor loo, a yard at the rear, and a coal house beyond this. A door at the back of the yard led out into an alley, a cobbled track scattered with rubbish and abandoned cars, a favourite playground for kids. The traffic had slowed Jack down badly in the latter part of the journey, and it was about 20 minutes later when he drove slowly down Grimm's Road trying to read the door numbers. He had received 2 other calls asking where he was, and it was fairly obvious that Briggs would not be in a sympathetic mood. Jack parked the car and pulled on an overcoat, keeping a wary eye on the darkening sky.
"Nice car, mister," said a cheeky lad with a grubby face, trying to bounce a football that had a puncture.
His friend, whose face his mother had cruelly forgotten to smear with grime that morning, joined in.
"Zowie!" he exclaimed excitedly. "An Austin Allegro Estate Mark III Deluxe 1.3-litre 1982 model. Applejack with factory-fitted optional head restraints, dog cage and Motorola single-band radio." He paused for breath. "You don't see many of those around these days." "It's not surprising," he added. "They're total shite."
"Listen," said the first one in a very businesslike tone. "Give us 50 quid and we'll set it on fire so you can cop the insurance."
"Better make it a tenner," said the second lad with a grin. 50 is all he'd get."
"Police," said Jack. "Now piss off." The boys were unrepentant.
"Plod pay double. If you want us to torch your motor, it's going to cost you 20.
They both sniggered and ran off to break something. Jack walked up to the house in question and looked at the shabby exterior. The guttering was adrift, the brickwork sprouted moss, and the rotten window frames held several sheets of car that had been stuck there to replace broken panes. In the window, the landlady had already put up a sign saying, "Room to let, strictly no pets, accordion players, statisticians, smokers, sarcastics, spongers, or aliens." Waiting for Jack was a young constable who looked barely out of puberty, let alone probation, which was pretty near the truth on both counts. He had made full constable and been sent to the NCD for 3 months to ease him into policing. But someone had mislaid the paperwork and he was still there 6 months later, which suited him just fine. "Good morning, Tibbet."
"Good morning, sir,"
replied the eager young man, his blue serge pressed into a fine crease by his mother, Jack guessed.
"Where's the super?"
Tibbet nodded in the direction of the house.
"Backyard, sir. Watch the landlady. She's a dragon. Jabbed me with an umbrella for not wiping my feet."
Jack thanked him, wiped his feet with great care on the faded and clearly ironic welcome doormat and stepped inside. The house smelt musty and had large areas of damp on the walls. He walked past the peeling wallpaper and exposed lath and plaster to the grimy kitchen, then opened the door and stepped out into the backyard. The yard was shaped as an oblong, 15 feet wide and about 30 feet long, surrounded by a high brick wall with crumbling mortar. Most of the yard was filled with junk, broken bicycles, old furniture, a mattress or two. But at one end, where the dustbins were spilling their rubbish onto the ground, large pieces of eggshell told of a recent and violent death. Jack knew who the victim was immediately, and had suspected that something like this might happen for a number of years. Humpty Dumpty. The fool guy. If this wasn't under the jurisdiction of the Nursery Crime Division, Jack didn't know what was. Mrs. Singh, the pathologist, was kneeling next to the shattered remains, dictating notes into a tape recorder. She waved a greeting at him as he walked over, but did not stop what she was doing. She indicated to a photographer areas of particular interest to her, the flash going off occasionally and looking inordinately bright in the dull closeness of the yard.
Briggs had been sitting on a low wall talking to a plainclothes policewoman, but as Jack entered, he rose and waved a hand in the direction of the corpse.
"It looks like he died from injuries sustained falling from a wall," Briggs said. "Could be accident, suicide, who knows. He was discovered dead at 7:22 this morning."
Jack looked up at the wall. It was a good 8 feet high. A sturdy ladder stood propped up against it.
"Our ladder?"
"His."
"Anything else I need to know?"
"A couple of points. Firstly, you're not exactly Mr. Popular with the seventh floor at present. There are people up there who think that spending £250,000 on a failed murder conviction for three pigs is not value for money, especially when there is zero chance of getting it into amazing crime stories."
"I didn't think justice was meant to have a price tag, sir."
"Clearly, but it's a public perception thing, Spratt. Piglets are cute, wolves aren't. You might as well try and charge the farmer's wife with cruelty when she cut off the mice's tails with a carving knife."
"I did."
"And?"
"Insufficient evidence."
"A good thing I never heard of it. So what you're going to do here is clean up Humpty's tumble with the minimum of fuss and bother. I want it neat, quick and cheap, and without hassling any more anthropomorphised animals."
"Including pigs?"
"Especially pigs. You so much as look at a bacon roll, and I'll have you suspended."
"Is there a third point?"
"The annual budgetary review is next week, and because of that pig fiasco, the NCD's future is on the agenda. Stir up any more trouble and you could find yourself managing traffic volume on the M4.
"I preferred it when there were only 2 points.
"Listen, Jack," went on Briggs. "You're a good officer, if you're a little over-enthusiastic at times, and the nursery crime division is necessary, despite everyone's apparent indifference. The bottom line is that I want this ex-egg mopped up neat and clean and a report on my desk Wednesday morning. The Sacred Gonga's new visitor's centre is being dedicated by the Jelly Man on Saturday, and I need all the hands I can get for security, and that includes your little mob hiding down there at the NCD.
"You want me to head up Jelly Man security, sir?" asked Jack, with a gleam in his eye. He liked the idea of being near the great man. Guaranteeing his safety was even better.
"No, we need someone of unimpeachable character, skill and initiative for that. Chimes is already drawing up security plans. No, I want you to ensure the safety of the Sacred Gonga itself. Anti-Splotvian protesters might try to disrupt the dedication ceremony. Protect it with your life and the lives of your department. Solomon Grundy paid $40 million to keep it in the country, and we wouldn't want to upset him. You should go and recce the visitor's centre. There'll be a Jellyman security briefing on Thursday at 1500 hours.
"Sir, I
would consider taking the assignment with all enthusiasm, Jack," observed Briggs. "After that three pigs debacle, you'll need as many friends as you can get."
"Is this where I say thank you?"
"You do."
Briggs beckoned the policewoman over.
"Jack, I want you to meet Detective Sergeant Mary."
"Hello," said Jack.
Mary,
said Mary.
Hello? "Don't play the fool, Spratt," cut in Briggs.
"It's Mary, explained Mary. "That's my name."
Mary, where are you from? Baden?
"First time I heard that one, sir. Today?"
Jack sighed. He smiled mechanically, she smiled mechanically, and they shook hands.
"Pleased to meet you, sir," she said.
"And you," replied Jack. "Who are you working with?" She looked across at Briggs rather pointedly.
"Mary is your new detective sergeant," said Briggs. "Transferred with an A1 record from Basingstoke. She'll be with you on this case and any others that spring up."
Jack sighed.
"No offence to DS Mary, sir, but I was hoping you could promote Ashley, Baker, or..."
"Not possible, Jack," said Briggs in the tone of voice that made arguing useless.
He looked up at the ominous sky.
"Well, I'm off. I'll leave you here with Mary so you can get acquainted. Remember, I need that report as soon as possible. Got it?"
Jack did indeed get it, and Briggs departed. Jack shivered in the cold and looked at her again.
Mary, eh?
"Yes, sir."
"Kind of an odd name." Mary bit her lip. It was a contentious point with her, and the years had not diminished the hot indignation of playground taunts regarding contrariness. It was an odd name, but she tried not to let her feelings show.
It's just my name, sir. I come from a long line of Mary Marys, sort of like a family tradition. Why, she added more defensively, is there a problem?
Not at all, replied Jack, as long as it's not an affectation for the guild's benefit. Briggs was threatening to change his to Fongots Killerney.
Why would he want to do that?
Freeland Chimes' investigations usually end up in print, as you know, explained Jack, and Briggs is habitually not referred to. He thought a strange name and a few odd habits might make him more mention-worthy.
Hence the trombone.
Right. There was a short silence, during which Jack thought about who he would have preferred to have as his DS, and Mary thought about her career.
So, the NCD disbanded, she said, using her best woeful voice to make it sound like terribly bad news. That would mean all the staff would have to be reassigned to other duties, right?
Along with the chairs and table lamps, yes, I suppose so.
When is this budgetary meeting?
A week next Thursday. Mary made a mental note. The sooner she could get away from this loser department, the better. Jack turned his attention to the shattered remains of Humpty's corpse. Mary took her cue and flicked open her notepad.
Corpse's name is...
Humpty Dumpty.
You knew him?
Once, Jack sighed, shaking his head sadly. A very long time ago. Humpty's ovoid body had fragmented almost completely and was scattered among the dustbins and rubbish at the far end of the yard. The previous night's heavy rain had washed away his liquid center.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.